Desert Island Discs on 91.3 Capital FM.
Welcome, it's 91.3 Capital FM's Desert Island Discs, now bigger and better on YouTube and every other platform that you can reach at the palm of your fingers. Welcome to the special edition. My name is Simon Kasiate, and as always, bringing you distinguished folks that have distinguished themselves. Oftentimes, they are ordinary folks, but with extraordinary life stories. But tonight on the program, I have a distinguished gentleman, well into his retirement, living the life of a fulfilled life, but most importantly, having served humanity for over 4 decades in international civil service. I have the pleasure of meeting the one and only Dr. Jones Yosia Chaze. Welcome to the program.
Thank you very much, Simon. It's a pleasure for me to be on your program. It's a famous program. I've heard about it from friends.
Wow.
And I was really very happy and surprised to learn that he chose me among the so many pretenders, so many other people who were even more worthy than me, but he chose me. So I'm very happy to be here.
Your humility will take you many places, Mr. Chaze. But what we can tell you on the program is that you would be nowhere close to the word pretender. You have an accomplished life in every sense of the word.
Thank you very, very much.
If anything, we are the ones with the pleasure of being in your presence. You allowing us to come for us to listen to the wisdom, knowledge, and experience you've gathered over the years.
Thank you very much. Yeah.
He will tell us his life story, but I just need to tell it to you in the most succinct but well-choreographed manner. That I'm speaking to a colossus in every sense of the word. He's worked at the UNESCO at the highest level. And you know about UNESCO heritage sites in Uganda. Kasubi Tombs being one of those. Now, if you're asking yourself how Kasubi Tombs got to on the list of heritage sites by UNESCO, perhaps tonight you'll get your answer. But I can tell you it's not far away from the man we're hosting this evening. He's an accomplished author. He's also an avid reader. I'm holding his latest book, The Making of an International Civil Servant, An Incredible Journey. Now, if you want to start on this journey of thousands of miles into career development, this is a book to have. But most importantly, this is the program tonight to listen to. Now I turn to you.
Thank you.
You have done it all, seen it all, and now you are literally lying on a hammock and sipping on pina colada. How does it feel to be in retirement?
Oh, it feels good. I mean, not having to wake up on the clock because we've got to be somewhere by 9 o'clock going through the traffic. Especially the longest time I served was in Paris. And Paris traffic is terrible.
You were also in New York. We had to study that in high school, that the worst problems you can find in New York is congestion and traffic.
That's right. Yeah, I lived also in New York, where there was also a lot of traffic. But you said that I've covered it all. Sometimes I have a feeling that I limited my life too much, but because many of my friends either started off as civil servants in their own countries, and then came, joined UNESCO later. But I started, it was almost my very first
job.
The first job I had gotten was at the University of Makerere, because that was at a time when they used to retain
the best students in a particular faculty.
Students were not too bad.
They used to retain them
and then move them into being lecturers eventually. I started off for that, and I was supposed to be lecturing in history department, mainly covering the French-speaking countries, and also the Library Africana.
Wow.
So those were my two. But then when I went abroad, they wanted me to come back too quickly, and I really wanted to master the French. So we disagreed, so I broke the contract and stayed over to perfect my French.
So vous parlez c'est bon français. Now that's the most they can speak in French.
Oh, oui, je peux parler en français. Je peux enseigner en français parce que j'ai travaillé beaucoup en français, aussi bien à Paris, au Sénégal, que à travers les pays francophones d'Afrique et d'ailleurs.
C'est beau. If only you knew that I am just picking a few words and then trying to remember the conjugation of
the conjugation.
Them. And then, of course, trying to translate them back to English and my mother tongue.
Oh,
appreciate them, then come back
then
to
come
you.
Back.
Oh, it's such a long journey.
Such a long journey.
But that's tremendous. So, and again, like I said, I just can't wait to dive into how your life story morphs.
Yeah.
But let's start from the beginnings.
Yes.
Yosia Chaze, at least from what I've gathered from your book,
yes,
were the exact names of your grandfather.
That's right.
So tell us from where it all began. Where were you born? To whom were you born?
Oh.
When were you born?
Oh, well, I was born quite long ago, I think before your dad was born.
Perhaps.
I was born in 1943.
Wow.
I was born at Mulago Hospital. But of course, by then, my parents were living at Natete.
Mm-hmm.
Somehow, my father and my grandfather shared the same compound. Of course, it was a big compound at Natete, not far from Makai Memorial College.
Oh, okay.
So I grew up between my father and my grandfather.
As it was always a big homestead.
But my grandfather had a lot of children, but only my father, I don't know, for some reason, stayed on that compound.
Mm-hmm.
So now, but I was much more with my grandfather, my father. My father was a big politician, at least in the Buganda context.
Mm-hmm.
So he was always rarely at home. He was in meetings. And so I stayed a lot with my grandfather.
And perhaps that was the time when they were also agitating for the independence of this country.
That's right. So he was part of that group.
Mm-hmm.
My grandfather had retired by then.
Mm-hmm.
So I had a lot of time. In fact, I remember I lost one full year of education because my grandfather, my primary school was just next to our home. So I was always be called from the class from time to time. Each time that my grandfather wanted to go somewhere, he would call me from class.
To come and walk with him.
And then the teachers could not dare say no because, of course, he was he had been the Minister of Finance in Kabaka's government.
No kidding.
He had
the Kabaka's government of
Daudi Chwa and later on of Mutesa, but much of the time of Daudi Chwa.
Then your father joins the government of OHT Sekabaka Mutesa.
As speaker of the Buganda Luchiko.
Wow.
That conflict between my father and my father wanting me to pursue my studies and my grandfather keeping me out from now and then and now
using
and then.
You as a runner for his errand. Uh-huh. Now that he was an
so
old
my father moved me out of that school, primary school, and took me to Agri Memorial School. Agri Memorial School has got its history is that my father had taught at King's College, Budo, with the other, especially Baganda guys.
Mm-hmm.
Now, they had a conflict between the British and those teachers. There were, I think, about 10, more than 10 of them.
Mm-hmm.
Because when Mutesa was enthroned, Mutesa II,
yes,
they British teachers and of course the headmaster were all teaching. The administration was mainly white Europeans. These guys put up Mutesa's photograph,
mm-hmm,
and the Bazungu insisted he should come down.
From where? Where had they?
In the one of the main rooms in the
at the school at the college school,
at the college, and I think they also had a party. They had a party to celebrate the enthronement,
yes,
which again the whites did not appreciate because it stayed too long. So finally, they resigned.
En masse.
Yeah. They resigned en masse. And they came and put up Agri Memorial School.
Ah. So who was Agri?
Agri was an American, one of the early American, anti-racist protesters, kind of. The kind of Martin Luther King type.
Okay, but white.
No, he was the black.
Oh, okay.
He was a black guy. And I think he settled in Ghana eventually. My father wanted me to go to that school.
Which was a primary school.
It was primary, but it went on to primary secondary school eventually.
Ah.
But by then it was a primary school. And then his brother-in-law, with whom again he had come from Budo, was the headmaster of the school.
So you were in the right
place. So I ended there to do my primary. But this kept me far away from my grandfather, who was calling me from the class, you know, from time to time to accompany him. And he used to walk from Natete to Rubaga to Mengo to seeing his fellow retired
civil servants. But then there were no means of mobility, not even a bicycle?
No, even cars were there. But my grandfather, as a matter of principle, because people would stop. You know, of course, he was again tall, you cannot miss him.
Mm-hmm.
People's cars would stop. Say, oh, which Tiwa? Where could we take you? He said, no. I'm there.
We're in
India. But for me, I know very well that you're going to visit his daughter, who lives in Makerere.
So from Natete?
From Natete.
You walk to?
To Makerere.
So in you here, you have got mileage of about what? 200,000 miles?
So, but then, quickly, I must say that I don't regret, because I missed a whole year. Because by the end of the year, the teachers realized that I had hardly been in the class.
You spent the year visiting old retired people.
So, my father was very annoyed. But when I think about it, I learned much, much more from my grandfather than what I would have learned in the class. I learned about service. I learned about being humble. I learned especially about service.
And humility.
And humility from my grandfather. And even what we call in Luganda, Omuganda takula bwatyo.
Omuganda. Alianga atambula.
Taha.
Tayogerangaria.
You'll buy you some pancakes mm-hmm. on the way, but to wait until you get home. And you know, you'll be edging to.
The aroma of the pancakes from your pocket is killing you.
So.
I said, no.
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 You know, as you're walking, you pee pee, you want to do pee pee. Yes, yeah. No, Muganda doesn't do that. You know? Yeah, you can't do that. So there were a lot of things which that Banaga and Babatia, what would the people say? Mm. And that for me, it was one of those education things. Things I can't, even in the dark.
You can't do.
You can't do because you know a Muganda does not do that. You cannot say one thing and then do another thing.
But Yosia, your grandfather gave you both his names, Yosia Chaze.
Yeah.
Which was a problem for your father because he couldn't start calling you, where Yosia? Because then he would be calling his father's name.
His father, who is in the sitting room somewhere.
Why do you think he gave you his name? Of all his grandchildren.
You know, that's something which again surprises me. Because it's not throwing flowers to myself. But among my fellow grandchildren,
mm-hmm.
I think I'm one of those who has had the opportunity to excel in my own way. Now, when I go back to those days, because the grandfather would give you his names, you know, he'll give you the names when you are by, not even a year.
You don't know.
Almost as soon as you are born.
Born, yes.
They take you to your grandfather to name you. Now, when this guy takes this little boy of 1 year
even
and sees beyond
the band of joy he's holding,
you know, to say that, you know, yeah, this you deserve having both my names. How does he, what does he see in the eyes of this little boy, little baby? But I know that much of the blessing, because I think I can't say that I have got what I've got, I've done. Because I think I've done, that's why I like the Shadi Bassey's song.
The one you play first.
My way.
Yes.
I've done almost everything my way. And I've lived in places I've dreamt to live in. When I was at school, I dreamt of living in Paris, living in New York, living in London. And curiously living in Lagos, to see what Lagos is,
looks like, yeah.
Living in Dakar, Senegal.
Wow.
And I've been able to live in all those places at no charge.
Those are the blessings of your grandfather. So is it therefore, must be true what the Baganda say?
Ateli soriyo mukuru. Awo dugale walava. That's right. And, but that's really, I've never been able to imagine that those blessings.
Are you a grand, you're a grandfather now, aren't you?
Yes, I'm a grandfather now.
Have you had the pleasure to name your grandchild?
Yes.
Uh-huh.
Oh, yes, I've had the pleasure of naming my two grandchildren.
Very good.
Yeah.
So now I'm sure you know the experience your grandfather went through as he named you.
Yes, I think so.
In your book.
But again, you know, I was not one of the first. There had been many grandchildren who had passed before
That's
me.
That's exactly what I'm saying. That why of all did he choose you?
Yeah, this is the blessing, which is...
The jury is still out there. We are not very sure why.
I'm not sure.
In your book, The Making of an International Civil Servant, My Incredible Journey, you write in the dedication and say, the people you're dedicating this book include your beloved mother, Mrs. Jane Namugenyi Namusisi Chaze, who loved, consoled, and counseled you while you lived with your stepmother away from her.
That's right.
Tell us about your mother.
Oh, my mom. Oh, my mom was the first of a very beautiful girl. She was born in Bokoto, not far from Bokoto, Bokoto, Kampala. And
which was a village then, I guess.
Which was a village then. And she only had one brother. There were two of them, brother and sister. A very simple man in a very simple house, which is still existing.
Oh.
Oh, yeah. And she was about 16 when she got married to my father. My father was then, I've done the calculations, my father must have been about 35.
35-year-old.
35-year-old.
Picks a 16-year-old, right?
I'm not even sure that he met, I think, grandfather and other brothers and people, I think, thought he was getting a little bit too old to get married.
Was that his first wife?
That was his first wife.
So they must have much made or quickly arranged.
I suspect so.
Uh-huh.
But she was very polite, very humble, very nice girl. Now, but again, very stubborn. Very stubborn, very strong character.
Ah, strong-willed.
Strong-willed. So she was a Catholic, but my father was an Anglican. So she changed from Catholicism to become an Anglican. And then along the way...
She continued reciting her rosary.
My father... My father changed again from Anglicans to Seventh-day Adventists.
Wow.
So, but that religion is very good, but also very special. You can't eat touch pork. You can't walk such a distance on a Sabbath. You can't... I think in those days you cannot even cook.
On Sabbath.
On Sabbath.
Because what do you eat? You cook on Friday.
You cook on Friday. Of course, no alcohol. Even other things, I don't think they eat.
They eat
grasshoppers. Maybe not. You don't can't eat duck. So it was too complicated for her. And they had to separate.
Just because she couldn't eat.
I think because the new religion was too complicated for her.
It was changing her timing.
completely. And I suspect it was not a very bad separation because I think my father must have helped her to set herself up in Kamocha, where she had a very famous bar.
Which one was this?
Yellow Bar. It was called Yellow Bar.
This was in which years?
Hey, that was, must be 50s, maybe.
Before independence?
Oh, it was far before independence.
Oh, well, that's interesting.
It was far before independence. I didn't leave that story. By the time I started knowing, I think they already separated.
Wow.
So, but she was a very strong-willed lady. And very, she had business acumen, what you call it, business acumen. Big, you know, she had lots of buildings. And I am happy to say that one of my sisters has gotten that acumen. She looks very much like my mother.
Wow.
Physically. But she's such a strong businesswoman in town.
And before your mother left, you and your sister were born. Did you have other siblings from her?
No, when they separated, my mother had other siblings.
Oh, had other children.
Other children.
Okay.
Yeah. In fact, from an Islamic
Did she convert to Islam?
She didn't, but she almost, because I remember her getting very busy cooking what they call daku, pilau, for the, so she wasn't. Again, it was a problem actually for the husband, because Muslims were not very appreciative of the fact that he, as a good Muslim, is living with a woman who is not a Muslim. But they survived.
Wow, that's a very interesting, strong-willed character.
Yeah.
On this program, we play our music.
Yes.
I told you that.
Yes.
So I have the pleasure to invite you to play your first song, sir.
My first song is My Way by Shari Bassey. Yeah.
You said if you had the pleasure to learn how to sing,
yeah,
that would be the first song you would sing.
That would be the first song I would learn to sing.
Why do you think you can't sing? Have you tried?
No, I've not tried. Mm-hmm. But you cannot say that you know unless you've never tried.
You're in retirement.
Yeah.
How about trying a singing career right now?
Oh.
At least for your personal pleasure.
My personal pleasure, I'll be diverting too much, because my personal pleasure now is in writing.
Wow.
And reading. And reading is I don't know whether this recent period, there's so many books coming out, interesting books coming. I've just read, I read a book, I think one of the best, is a book by Awichi Apore Makubuya.
Oh yes, The Politics. No, he has, that's
Yeah.
The one of Apore Makubuya is an...
It must have taken a lot of research. I don't know whether you've seen it.
I have a copy.
You have a copy.
It,
you
know, speaks to the kingdom like he was actually there watching his eyes.
500 pages. I had to sit down and read through it, because he's a very good friend. In fact, he's the one who...
I see some acknowledgments to his name.
At the launching of this book. So reading, I think, takes a lot of my time. Then writing, of course, takes a lot of time, because you have to do some research, especially the one I'm working on now. Then I'm in Rotary, which takes quite a bit of my time. But also now I'm more and more involved in the family affairs.
I notice you are one of the leaders, and I see it here in the Lugave clan.
Yeah, then I'm also committee. In the Lugave clan, very much involved.
You heard the Ndongobukaba.
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 Ndongobukaba sub-clan. But I'm also, you know, our head of the clan, Ndugwa, he feels tired and is not very well in terms of health. So he wanted to step aside. But the tradition and the Kabaka did not allow him to do that. So, but he somehow delegated his day-to-day management of the clan to about five of us.
Wow.
So that takes a bit of our time to run the clan on behalf of our
clan head. Later on, of course, on the program, we'll be getting into the depth of what it means to run a clan.
Oh, okay.
The corporate governance, the cultural governance, and everything in between.
Okay.
But for now, let's have it your way.
Thank
and play
you.
Your music. We're starting with My Way.
My Way. Thank you very much.
It's the Desert Island Discs. We'll be right back.
Desert Island Discs on 91.3 Capital FM.
I plan. Each careful step along the byway, and more, much more than this, I did it my way.
Yes. 91.3 Capital FM Desert Island Discs, now bigger and better on YouTube. Welcome once again. If you just joined us, we're listening to the life story of an international civil servant that has served with distinction for over four decades.
Over three decades.
And
32 and a half years to be exact.
Wow, 32 and a half years. Running at the highest level with the UNESCO, which is an agency of the United Nations. Working in places such as Paris, working in New York, and in other places like Dakar, Senegal, Lagos, Nigeria. And now happily retired back home.
Yes.
So Chizé, let's go back again. You know, your grandfather, your father.
Yeah.
There's that tiff of where to place you. And you finally sit your primary seven from Agri Memorial.
That's right.
Where then did life take you?
Then life takes me. No, it used to be primary six.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay.
It used to be primary
six. Thanks for the correction.
At Agri Memorial School. And then from there, I go to Macquarie College School. Macquarie College School, I think it was a. Agri Memorial School was a very good school.
Mm-hmm.
They start you off very well, ground you in very well in Luganda and English, but especially Chiganda culture.
Oh.
And by then, that school was at now where we find St. Lawrence University. That's where Agri Memorial School was. As you can see, very close to the palace.
Yes.
So we're very close to the palace. All the activities in the palace were most of the time involved. For instance, during the Kabaka's birthday, they would clean up the palace naturally for that big day. They would redo the reeds.
The reed fence.
The defense and all that.
Then a chitirwa, that arch.
And we're all involved as small kids.
Where would they find those reeds anyway?
Oh, I don't know. They would bring them, I would find them. For us, we're used.
And there were people who would wash them.
Wash them, that's right. That's it. So, that I think was the first grinding of kingship loving in me. So then we got to to Macquarie College School.
Naturally, of course, you couldn't go to King's College Budo because, again, of the experience your father had had with the administration.
I couldn't go. That was partly because of my stepmother.
Oh.
I had the opportunity to go to Budo, and my stepmother said there was no money. Take me to Budo. Because the Macquarie College School was a day school. I used to walk. Occasionally, my father would take me, but each time he would take me there late. So I prefer to walk.
To walk. How would he take you? What means of mobility did he have?
He had a car.
Wow.
What car? He was a speaker of the
Luchiko.
All the ministers in the Buganda government had cars. Because they were paid civil service. They were very, very well paid. I should have stayed in Macquarie College School.
Mm-hmm.
But then here comes all the Kampala Secondary School.
Mm-hmm.
Because I was in scouting. Even when I was at Macquarie College School, even at Agri Memorial School, I was in scouting. And we used to meet them in the camps. And I used to see them come to the camps with all sorts of equipment. And then I got
looking
more
sophisticated.
Curious. Sophisticated.
So for the jamborees, you'd say, oh.
So I decided that I want to go to all the campus and secondary school, which was by then, I think all the time I was in the school, we're about 10 Africans maximum. The other 1,000 and more
were Indians.
And my attraction was the equipment, the sports. They had the boxing, the scouting, they had those rucksacks. So I convinced my dad to change from college school to go to the Kampala Secondary School. He did not like it in the first place. But then he knew, I think he sensed, that if he insisted, it might disturb me.
Mm-hmm.
So he allowed me to go there. And when he went to this, I remember this scene very well. Went to this old Kampala Secondary School to see the headmaster, who was an Indian, of course. And naturally, my father being the speaker, he was quite late in to see the headmaster. And he said, this boy wants to join this school.
Mm-hmm.
So the headmaster asked, where is he from? So the dad said, well, he's been in Macquarie College School. I said, what? You want him to leave college school and come here?
Why?
I said, I don't know. But the boy wants this school. And that was it. He just said, the boy wants this school. And I think they must have sensed that, you know, this
there must be something.
Must be
more
something.
More than meets the eye.
More than, yeah. So I was into the whole school, all the campus in this kind of school. Where I was very happy. I had a very good time for the...
Which class were you in then?
That was now senior one.
Uh-huh.
Because as I said, we did primary six.
Mm-hmm.
And then you got to do 7 and 8, which was the junior secondary school.
Mm-hmm.
And then from there you got to senior one. So I did senior one to senior four in the same school. And then senior five to senior six in the same school. And I was very successful in the school because... I was in acting there.
Mm-hmm.
I became the school sports captain.
Wow.
Became the school head prefect.
So you loved it all, but from an extracurricular point of view.
Oh yeah, mainly. In fact, I should say this. In school, my schooling, my education, I've never taken the schooling so importantly. And I must admit, I've never been one of the brightest students in classroom work. My successes were often
on the track and fields and
on the track and field, in debates,
on
in
podiums,
in scouting, in acting, even at Makerere. I couldn't be the same thing, because when I was at Makerere, again, the same thing, I was president of the Baganda students.
Which, whoa, that must have been huge.
Which today, Mkobazambogo. They used to call it Banaba Buganda. And then the president was called Sabaganda. So wow. Some of my old friends,
when they meet you,
they meet me, they call me Sabaganda. So when I'm in the crowd and they say, Sabaganda, I just turn and I know that. So then I was, of course, in acting. Then I was in the guild council. I was still doing athletics. But then also, and then, of course, in those days, Makerere, we were the best clients for all the bars.
in the neighborhood.
And nightclubs in the neighborhood.
And that's how Wandegeya gets its fame and name.
The Susanna. So.
You had a good time.
We had a good time.
Where were you on the 8th of October, 1962?
I was a student at Old Kampala Senior Secondary School. Yeah, because I left in 65.
Okay.
So wow. By 62, I was
in between.
In between.
So you remember the independence of this country.
Oh, yeah.
And the fanfare and the...
Oh, yeah. And the enthusiasm, and we're all looking forward to a new country, to lots of good things. We didn't realize
it was going to be something quite not what you thought.
Like I pity the students who got Makerere today. It's such a different place than the place we went to. It is. It's so terrible that almost everything has tended to deteriorate instead of improving. I cannot name anything which has improved since independence. In terms of quality, I cannot name anything. Maybe a few things like houses, the more
sophisticated
houses.
They are bigger than they should be.
More fellow Africans have got good houses. But apart from that, the infrastructure.
Public infrastructure
is just deteriorated. But again, the things like the institutions of learning, the schools, even my old school, Old Kampala, is
now at the old.
This is old
Kampala, indeed.
But Makerere is what, you know, the university is what shocks, because the university was, it was something different. When you have to just one, maximum if you are two in a room, It was a punishment.
Now I think they have deckers in there.
Can you imagine? A decker in the university.
So, Mr. Chaze, let's play our next song.
Okay. Then shall we do Twalia Kwebe Twalia?
He did, by Eddie Wamala.
By Eddie Wamala.
He must have been one of those that whose shows and music you patronized in your younger years.
Yeah, in fact, Eddie Wamala and another guy who passed on, Fred Kanyike. They are the two guys who took me for the first time in a nightclub. I think I was still in the senior 3 or senior 4 somewhere.
Really?
And I remember we went on a scooter.
Three of you.
A Vespa, the three of us. And the first one we went to was at that White Nile. In Kakatwe.
Where the scooters bigger than they are today, or you guys were a lot smaller for three of you to fit on the scooter?
No, there were two types. There was one with a longer deck.
Uh-huh.
And yeah.
So who was the guy riding it?
It was Freddy. Fred was riding, and I think Eddie Wamala was at the back, and I was in the middle.
In the middle. So Eddie Wamala was a personal friend.
We went to the same school Makany Memorial College. But he was a much bigger boy than me. I don't know where the friendship struck. Sometimes because you are a son of a chief next door. And then I was a little bit noted too. I think because they used to call me Kalidaru.
They used to call me Kalidaru. Because people who patronized dance halls then were not necessarily the very ordinary folks. They were always derogatory referred to as.
But I don't know how. Well, maybe it was more with Kanyike. Fred was his friend. And one evening they just said, you know, do you want to go and see White Nile? So I went. So I think we really struck at Natete. He was must have been 3 or 4 years. Then we met later on, much later, because one of my first cousins, Dan Chaze,
Dan Chaze, the famous Dan Chaze that you read news on TV.
That's right.
Now that you mention his name, I'm beginning to see a bit of resemblance.
He's our fathers, our brothers.
Wow.
Our brothers.
Let's play your song, The Story of Dan Chaze, then we'll come in after that, if you don't mind.
Oh, okay.
Twaria Kobe Bitwaria, a song by Eddie Wamala, an all-time classic, a song that I'm sure you will love for a Sunday evening. Beautiful one, I must say. We'll be right back.
Desert Island Discs on 91.3 Capital FM.
Twaria Kobe Twaria, Yasigarida. Yeba msai mto aganira sokolero enkindu zinamubuna mwana kwenga twachakala guno chikwangala kumlembo kwa fuku twabela koba msai mto.
It's Desert Island Discs, and we're still conversing with Mzee Chaze Yosia Jones. He loved his Jones. He still loves his Jones names. You said your Jones names is a sophisticated name. Also, you realized as you grew up.
No, I realized because when I say my name, that's most of your name. I say my name is Jones. Oh, James. No, Jones.
Jones.
Jones. But Jones, you know, there's Jones with an S after John. The normal John.
And the normal John. The Johnny.
The Johnny. And then, so, and sometimes I dropped it. When I was in Ode Kampala, I think I didn't use Jones so much.
But Yosia?
Yosia I never used Yosia. I always abbreviated it to Y.
Why? So what did you use for it as a first name with Chaze?
Jones.
When you had dropped it?
When I dropped Yosia?
When you had dropped Jones.
Oh, I just used, you didn't have it was just a J.
So just a J Chaze.
J Chaze. And then some people started calling me J.
Wow.
So that took quite some time.
Oh, so for a long time you were also known as Jay.
I was also known as Jay.
Wow.
And then funny, when I was growing up, I was a small boy, when you asked me my name, I would say my name is Jonesy Chaze Yosia. I don't know why I
you
had that interchange. But it was automatic. What's your name? My name is Jonesy Chaze Yosia. And I don't know where that came from.
But we're glad that you remember. From Old Kampala.
Yeah, from Old Kampala.
You head out to Makerere.
Makerere University. In fact, I did not head to Makerere University straight. Mm-hmm. From Old Kampala, I had always loved to do two things. Mm-hmm. Law or international civil service. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to do law. So I applied to go to Dar es Salaam because we didn't have law at Makerere. If you wanted to do law, you had to go to the University of Dar es Salaam. So I applied to go to Dar es Salaam, and I was accepted. I went there. Just the first week, I didn't like it.
What didn't you like? The course, the people, the place?
The place was not as welcoming as Makerere. Mm-hmm. Then Nyerere was very, very tough then with his socialism.
Ujama.
Even the size of your trousers. Because I think by then we had these belly bottoms here.
Belly bottoms here and flares.
And he didn't like that. It had to be a certain size, which is the Eastern size. You see the Chinese. So then,
because that is wastage of material.
Again, this is again the strong will which sometimes puts us in trouble. I decided to leave and come back to Makerere.
What?
Now I come back to Makerere. That was, yep, as I said, I had just been there for about a week or 2 weeks, I think. I come back to Makerere, and of course I head up to the University of East Africa. So I go up to the registrar. I said to him, my dear, hey, this is okay, this is very well, but your first choice was Dar es Salaam. We don't have any space for you here.
Wow.
Ah. I said, but I can't take it that I can't go to Dar es Salaam. No. He was a nice guy. He was a guy called Eric Chigozi, was he? I think so. He just passed away a few years back.
Oh, dear.
So he said, I can be kind enough to let you in, but your big trouble is going to be residence. Because by then, there were no off-campus students. When you admit to Makerere, you have a room in one of the residences.
Wow.
So, but all the residences are now full by now.
They have their occupants.
They have all the occupants. So there's no way you can get into what's without. So he said, but wait a minute. I've seen your record. You've done a lot of sports, a lot of activities, head prefect, sports, this. Let's try Dinwiddie. Dinwiddie was the warden of a hall which was called Northcote.
Oh!
Northcote Hall. And he was very particular about the people he took. He did not want, he wanted people who were active.
He didn't want sissies. He wanted real boys.
He wanted real boys. So, he calls up Dinwiddie. He said, sounds interesting. Send him over. So I went to Dinwiddie. He said, look, I want you. It's not you wanting to be here, but I want to take you. Would you mind sharing a room temporarily?
As we
try to sort out. I said, fine. I'll share a room temporarily. Then suddenly I become a member of the Guild Council.
Wow.
In my first year. Then that gives him an excuse to ensure that I've got a single room.
What course had you been offered at the university anyway?
Supposed to do law.
Yes.
Now another complication was that they did not want me to do my law and French.
Mm-hmm.
And yet I wanted to do French. I had not done French in the secondary school, but I wanted to do it at the university.
That was quite some courage. You had never met French.
No.
Anywhere.
No.
And you are now interested in learning
French,
of course.
Yeah.
Way into your teenage years.
That's right. Now, when I was admitted to Makerere, I took French as a beginner, and history, and English. Language was always my interest. Now, then I had to compete with students, fellow students
who had
come from St. Mary's College, Kisubi, with fluent French. Even from Budo, they came with, they had been French. The Miriango College, they had done French. But I said, I want to do French. And I did. In fact, it almost failed me in my degree. Guess what?
Mm-hmm.
I came out best in French. And that's
what?
I earned a straight scholarship straight to France after my first
degree. After? Wow.
But I had dropped English too, because you had to do three first year, then you take one or two during the second year. So I dropped English, kept French, and kept history.
That was quite a brain. But university life can be very interesting, Mr. Chaz.
It can be.
Tell us about Makerere University of those days.
Makerere University of those
days. Especially from an extracurricular point of view.
It was very interesting. Because we had a lot of course, extra curricular. We had drama. We even had one group which was called a traveling theater, where this drama group would travel to various areas in the country, putting on plays.
Wow.
In the local communities. Then each hall had an annual dinner dance.
Wow.
Imagine all the halls. And then there was one organized by the guild.
The guild. So you would attend each of those.
Oh, yeah, naturally.
If you wanted to.
No, no.
But for you, it was, you had to.
No, we had to. Most of the students did. And then we had this, you had your single room. And then if you happen to be in a hall like Northcote,
mm-hmm.
where the warden was very liberal, very liberal. And then you had the boom.
That allowance that you kept
had that
you.
Allowance. Now imagine, you've got the in the bookshop, which was on the campus, the government puts there a lump sum for you, which you used to buy books, which was more than what you needed.
Mm-hmm.
Then, of course, you had this boom. Then, you, for me, I was working in the library in the afternoons.
Hey!
So, now, you had, of course, one or two lectures a day.
Mm-hmm.
So long as you can write your essay and whatever. I mean, things were quite
flexi time.
We had a lot of flex time, but nightclubs, weekends, of course, were nightclubs. Nightclubs, and again, those who are not strong enough fell by the wayside.
Of course,
especially we had this system of the first year is the toughest because you've got to pass. If you don't pass your first year,
you're out.
You're out. If you have not really just, then they would allow you to repeat. And if you repeat, they allow you to repeat. But before the year starts, you come back and do a retake and then continue. I've got a friend who came from the same school, or the Kampala Secondary School. This friend even ended up in education. But his was just books.
And nothing else.
Nothing else. And today, when I was doing this book, I went to visit him, hoping to give me some clues of the information I wanted.
I can imagine connecting the dots.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm.
This guy is just in the village. I got there around midday. He was just having his breakfast.
At midday.
On the veranda at midday. And he's, for me, that's not a life I would have. I think he never trained himself into any extracurricular. So he passed very well, all his degrees. But he ended up, because I think your brain and your body, your and brain, unless you really use them. So I can't admire his life. He's just seated in the village, sipping tea at midday.
At midday, while for you are in typical retirement. Such as they will play our next song.
Our next song. Let's do Namakula, but singing Eddie Wamala's song. Can't remember the title. I hope.
So Rema Namakula.
Rema Namakula.
The rendition of Eddie Wamala.
Eddie Wamala.
You love your music. Now I have confirmed. Mm. We'll be right back. It's Desert Island Discs.
Desert Island Discs on 91.3 Capital FM.
Jagala tubere senawe tusanyuke tijaguze abole kabakole fitina kachiba jugule kachiba konde.
Welcome back. And then of course along the way wish Steve Wachaze decided that we must have a glass of wine. I mean, how better can a Sunday evening go without a bit of a glass of wine? Especially from his many years of international civil service.
Cheers.
Where the etiquette is clear. Cheers indeed.
Yeah.
And he continues to tell us his life story.
Hmm.
Where were we? We were talking about your time at Makerere University.
At Makerere University. I think that was one of the best times. And as I keep saying, I still believe that what I gained at Makerere was not what were being lectured in the lecture rooms, but the intermingling, the exchanges with the fellow students,
mm-hmm.
either in acting, in debates, or political campaigns, when you're trying to enter the Guild Council, when you're trying to become the president of the Barnaba Buganda, in athletics, in drama, in nightclubs, in I think that was real life, educating us well. And I think the colonialists really did it purposely. Imagine the hall of residence, that you have your own room, you have your, and then the dining was out of this world. You have the best breakfast. If you want fried eggs, if you want omelette, if you want scrambled, you have the juice. You have the best breakfast, the sausages, and even the etiquette of walking into the dining room. Most of the time, you have to have your gown on.
Wow,
And then there are times when you invite to the high table. Because the dean, I mean the warden, and the resident tutors would sit at the high table for their dinner, and once a week, they would invite a few distinguished students to the high table. So all these things were meant to train us becoming gentlemen.
Wow.
In the world. So, as I said, the university really taught us to become gentlemen, civil servants.
But also that's the place where you met and appreciated the fairer sex.
Where are we?
You met and appreciated the fairer sex.
Yeah, it's true.
And that's where maybe your first dating, serious dating experience did take place.
That's right. First serious dating, no. In fact, it was less serious dating than in high school. In high school, I think we took our dates much more seriously than
at the university.
At the university, it was just having a good time. Just having a good time. Changed them around.
Because one, they were in a good supply, but also you had the facilities.
We had the facilities. But interestingly, many of the boys went out of the campus.
To get less sophistication, I guess.
For less sophistication, that's right. Yes, like when I was there, Lago Nursing Hostel was...
The to-go-to place.
Was it a good, yeah. We even had a club, a dancing club, which, you know.
We do exchanges.
Yeah, between them and us. Yeah, but I think off the campus, outside the lecture rooms, that's where life was very, 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 very interesting.
So, and this course you were doing, what other than teaching did you have in mind you were going to do?
International Civil Service. Once I dropped law, international civil service became my focus. And somehow things connected, but I already had this idea of international civil service. But I thought I would come home,
serve for some time,
and then go and but then when I came home very briefly. At Makerere, I came back to the university very briefly. But then a few things happened. Our vice chancellor was Yusuf Lule, who was, of course, vice chancellor. I mean, when it's true that you need this for the vice chancellor, he was educated. And then suddenly.
No surprises, he later became our president.
Then suddenly, Obote changes him and replaces him with his private secretary, Mr. Kalimuzo. He was not a bad man, but I mean, how do you get a private secretary of the prime minister suddenly becoming the vice chancellor of a university? So that's when I realized that, you know, these things are going to turn. So then I found my way out to go back, and then got into UNESCO.
The getting into UNESCO.
Yeah.
Were you already a married man, or you were a young
bachelor? No, I was a bachelor. I was single. Imagine living university life on a smaller stipend. I had a car, by then.
Which you had bought with what proceeds?
Oh, with proceeds from... at the university in France. No, I didn't have a car in France.
Oh, okay. So when you're talking about when you went to university in France.
Yeah, doing postgraduate in France. Yeah, I had a small old car.
Was it a Peugeot?
No, it was Citroën.
Oh, Citroën.
Citroën, but it was called Deux Chevaux, 2 horsepower. You don't put water in it. It was a simple, very simple, simple car. So from there, all of a sudden, I get this job in UNESCO in Paris, single, with lots of money, by my standards, by then, lots of money. And I knew Paris like my pocket.
The back of your hand.
On my part. We had a period where we had the ambassador.
Is this long street that goes through the marble arch of sorts?
Oh yeah, the Champs-Élysées.
That was your playground.
Now, then the ambassadors, as I was a civil servant in UNESCO, we had ambassadors.
Serving foreign missions were also civil servants, but in foreign service.
Well, especially the Ugandan one. There's a guy called Aksaferi, I forget his name, Ogola. Very like big lifeist. So he used to have parties. Then we had the Tanzanian guy, he was also a really lifeist. We had a guy from Liberia called James King. We had a guy from Nigeria. So we had a number of African ambassadors who had these parties. And then, of course, they have these big houses. They don't stay, most of them, in the set of Paris, but outside in the suburbs. So, and then with my car, one of my jobs
was to drive party
Drive friends back to their places and
after the parties and to the parties.
Interestingly, when you're in a place like Paris, many people don't use cars, especially neither the students nor the simple workers. They use the underground train.
Of course.
Now the underground train has got a problem. You can't know your way. Because you travel underground. You just come out of the hole and then drop
and
at where you're
Gare
going.
Gare de Lyon.
So when you're in a party, someone says, can you please drop me after the party? You say, yes. So you get out, you get in the car. So which way do we go?
I don't know. Just use the underground. Take me there.
So that forced me as a driver to learn my way around, because you've got to drop these friends left and right. What is also interesting in Paris are the cinema halls and the shows, the operas, the theater.
You are not a fan of football, Paris or Saint-Germain?
Paris Saint-Germain was not even there.
Oh!
It was created when I was there by a man called Jacques Chirac.
Yes, the
he
president.
He was the mayor of Paris.
Mm-hmm.
Before he became
president.
President. And he...
During the time of Mitterrand.
There was the time of Pompidou, I think. Either Pompidou or Mitterrand. I think Pompidou. So he created, when he was mayor, he was a very charismatic guy.
Oh, yes.
So he created that Paris Saint-Germain. There were two small teams. I think one was called Red Star and another one, which were weak, you know, kind of second division. So he made one
big team. Merged them to make one big team. So for you then, the life had begun, but on a high.
Yeah,
right from student life
to
a job in UNESCO.
That's right.
But I think now we need to connect the dots in the details. Like they say, the devil is in the details. Tell us, how easy or hard was this? A job is advertised, you put in an application, sit for interviews, and that was it?
No.
How was it?
No, it was again another lucky coincidence.
Mm-hmm.
When I was at that that university in Besançon, I had my small car. There was a Nigerian guy who was a high-level scientist from Nigeria. He was a physicist, a lecturer, I think, in the University of Ibadan. He was appointed to head the UNESCO Regional Office for Science and Technology, which is based in Nairobi, in Kenya. Just as the Dakar office in Senegal is for the whole of Africa, but in education. So this scientist comes on the scene, but he cannot express himself well in French.
Wow.
Because you have to have some French to be allowed into UNESCO. Of course, having some French is like some people learning it at school. It's not the operational French.
It's like my French of three words, a greeting, to wish you well and say bon chance.
No, even a few more words. But even when I left Makerere, I had done 3 years of French. But reaching in France,
it was a different ballgame.
It was different. I started almost from square one. My postgraduate, the teacher will be teaching, but the way he pronounces the words, you will not catch it. For instance, you say, Hitler. Hitler. Oh, that means Hitler.
What?
So he was talking about this big man in between the two world wars. And I was saying, but. And then I asked him, but so.
Hitler. Qu'est-ce que c'est?
So he was brought, this big director of the Regional Office for Science and Technology was brought to the University of Besançon
to learn,
to brush up his French, I think for 6 months or so.
Mm-hmm.
Now, luckily, he had been dating a Ugandan girl, you know, in those days there were very many Ugandan girls in Nairobi.
Wow, hey, because of...
There was also one secretarial school, Kyanda, I think,
mm-hmm.
which was in Kenya, not far from Nairobi. So, and of course, the Ugandan girls are so smart.
Of course.
They would take up all the international stuff. So this Ibukun got one of them from Toro. So by the time he came to Besançon to meet me, he already had experience
about
of Uganda.
And especially if he had come from that direction, uh-huh. He must have been such a daddy.
So he meets me and was very excited to see, because I think we were just two Ugandans in the university.
Quickly, you became a Muko.
Quickly, I became a Muko, but also I had a car.
Ah!
I had a car. If you saw in my book,
mm-hmm.
I took him.
I've seen you make a lot of references to him in the book.
Uh-huh. Because he's my godfather in UNESCO.
In UNESCO, yes. You make even so a special tribute to him in
right.
the book, yes.
Yeah. So he gets interested in me. We start talking. Of course, I mentioned my interest.
Mm-hmm.
But for now, as I was telling you,
mm-hmm.
my interest was to join UNESCO later after having served a few years
in Uganda.
He says, no, why do you have to? You don't have to go back to Uganda. Why don't you apply now?
Mm-hmm.
Apply now. It did not cost me anything. So I applied. And it's told.
For what particular job?
No particular job. Just working for UNESCO International Civil Service for me. And then there was a program where they were also looking out for young, what they qualified as smart, sharp, intellectual, whatever it
was. More like a graduate training program.
Uh-huh. So he asked me to apply. I apply. And then I was taken on as they called it, stagiaire. You know, the under sort of.
Wow.
And then I think about 15 hired. And then they started training us, sending us on small missions. I went to Algeria with another, I think we were five. By then we were about five. They had dropped all the others.
But when you saw the remuneration slip.
Yeah, it was good. It was good. So that's how I got in. And then when after coming back from Algeria, I think they retained all of us. The five.
How long were you in Algeria?
Oh, and we were just there for about a month.
Oh, then just came back and you were
looking
retained.
At their own. You're recruited, but again on probation. And you know what is interesting? All the other guys, all the five of us,
mm-hmm.
they were big guys. They became big guys. Because
your cohort of entrants.
That cohort of five. All of us.
Through the ranks.
Because Jinping, we could already see when he was in the group, he was one of the smartest.
Oh, you are with Jinping, the president of the African Commission.
Yes. We were recruited on the same day in UNESCO.
Wow.
He did not stay very long. Then the president called him back home. Next thing we knew, he was ambassador to UNESCO in Paris. Next thing we knew, he was minister of petroleum. Next thing we knew, he was a foreign affairs minister. Next thing you knew, he was AOU secretary general. So, and then the girl, the Japanese girl, became, I think, very high up also in the culture sector in UNESCO. The Russian guy who was with us became deputy foreign affairs minister in
Russia. I thought you were going to say the Russian guy is actually Vladimir Putin.
No. He was Michael Reshoff.
Mm-hmm.
That's how we got in. And then you are taken in as P1.
Wow.
And then you go up. I think two of us again dropped out eventually.
And you get in there, and it's just work, and your mind is clear, you're not coming back home. Didn't you miss home?
Actually, I missed home, but I didn't miss it.
I love that. You missed home, but you didn't miss it.
No. It is setting your goals is very important. Setting your goals, your objective. Because even when I was going out of Uganda for the first time to go to study,
mm-hmm.
I knew I was going to come back here by all means. And even when I joined UNESCO, from the very first day, I almost started preparing my retirement. Can you imagine?
What?
Almost started preparing my retirement.
Are you that kind of person that is so structured?
Yeah.
That you have an idea what you're going to wear next week on Wednesday?
Yeah, I'm structured. Because if not, first of all, I should have married a white person.
I was coming to that. Because I'm sure your socialization now in Paris, the city of romance.
It was enough for me.
I am pleasantly surprised.
It was enough for me, but I knew I was going to come back here. So each friend I got close to and intimate, that was one of the first discussions.
Look, we're not getting married. We're just for the
good times. I am here. As long as we are here, I am going home. So don't entertain an idea of neither having any children with me, nor of getting as close as
to get the
as a lifetime partner. And interestingly, people understood.
Wow.
So that was one of the first. So that shows if you are focused, blessings do help you.
You can comfortably say, if we look around the city of Paris, there are no fair-skinned chazes roaming around.
No.
I love that.
And that was a deliberate decision. I saw many of my friends getting hooked on to getting married to them. But no. So I knew I would be coming. I would come home. But then, again, to follow up that decision, I almost came home almost every year.
Just
all the 30 years.
We're checking, how is it?
Yeah,
how
almost. Then I started getting involved in smaller business, constructions, housing here, housing there. And my mother was still around. And then I've got friends who really also kept me
grounded, more or less.
Yeah, grounded.
Let's play your next song.
Some of them.
Yeah, let's play your next song. When we return, it's the coming home, if at all, or now you getting a partner, or you continuing with your work and growing in it.
Okay. My next song, can you find me a Jim Reeves? The Jim Reeves, there are many, almost any.
We will not play the usual one of this world is not my home. No,
okay,
this world is your home.
No, okay.
So we'll find another one.
Another one. There's one which I like, but I don't know whether it is easily available.
Trust me, this is capital.
Later to my heart. I think it's something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And it's, I think it's like a dear heart. Yeah.
You know, we agree that at some point you'll have to try out singing. So,
yeah.
Letters to My Heart from Jim Reeves. We'll try to find that from our music jukebox. But if we can't, like he said, any Jim Reeves does. And it's a Sunday evening. Why not? We'll try that.
Yeah, apart from this world, this world is not my home.
No.
Which I don't agree with. In fact, we should talk about my faith.
I love that. We'll get back to that.
Yeah.
But let's take a break and then come back.
Desert Island Discs on 91.3 Capital FM.
Dear heart, there is something I must tell you. Something sad and so hard for me to say.
Welcome back. It's OHT Word Doctor Jones Chaze. And he normally likes to add Yosia in the position of a surname. But now when he got into diplomacy and was polished a little bit, now he decided to put it in the right way. Doctor, or should we say OHT Word, Dr. Jones Yosia.
Wow,
Chaze.
How do you know?
Well, yeah, I mean, I have to know
better. That's how exactly it's done. It's not Dr. OHT Word, it's OHT Word. Doctor, yes.
Wow.
Yeah, I'm impressed.
I'm also impressed. You had a good life.
I had a good life.
But let's go back a bit to your life, the faith, the beliefs. Your father at one time becomes a Seventh-day Adventist. Do you convert with him?
No. It becomes a routine in a family when dad is going to church. And you like to go with it. On a strange day from where you were used to. Yeah. So you go to church with him, then you get baptized, then you are entrusted with some duties in the church, collecting money and all that.
Join the Pathfinders.
That's right. So it's part of the family routine.
Mm-hmm.
And then I think I was in senior six when I realized that really, you know, I did not believe in this kind of thing. First of all, I've never had faith,
mm-hmm.
which means, and when I tell people I don't believe in God, they misunderstand. I don't believe because I don't have the faith. It's not that I don't want to believe. I don't question his existence. All I say, I don't know. I have no feeling towards that.
Mm-hmm.
So I realized I was not being honest with my dad, who believed I was a Seventh-day Adventist like he was, and I was not. So I wrote him a letter. In fact, I remember that even I was staying in a hostel on Bombo Road when I was studying in Old Kampala to the A-levels. I wrote him a letter to say that, you know what, I don't believe in your Seventh-day Adventist church.
Mm-hmm.
Not because I don't like what's being done there, but I have no faith. Basically, I have no faith in witchcraft. I have no faith in divine intervention of God. So I have no faith, so I cannot continue. And then I had another problem. As you know, as being a sports captain, most of the sports are done on Saturday.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot do it on Saturday because it's Seventh-day Adventist. As head prefect, there are lots of things to get involved in. When I combined all that, so it was time for me to come out, to come clean.
What response did you expect from your father?
Can you imagine?
You knew he was going to.
He was going to blow up. He was going. So I go home one weekend and I said, we're sitting at breakfast. I said, Daddy, did you get my letter? Oh, yes, I got it. Yeah, thank you very much. I got it. No word, nothing. I was surprised,
mm-hmm.
but I thought I was very happy because I didn't want him to explain, to extend. I just wanted to know that he knew where I stood. Now I was waiting to see whether he was going to pressurize me or to preach to me. He did not. That was the end of my being a Seventh-day Adventist.
Today, do you profess any faith?
No. I don't profess any faith. Sometimes I miss it because I got married to
in
a very
church or by the, church. At the DC's office.
No, I got married in church. My first marriage, I got married in church, and I got married to a daughter of a canon of the church, a granddaughter of a canon of the church. And we lived, she accepted
your atheism.
My atheism. Well, that's a word we won't get into. but all I said, I don't believe. I don't feel it. So what I say, sometimes I miss it. Each time she's got a problem, she'll kneel down and pray. At least she's got something to run to. Me, when I've got a problem, I can run to Simon for help as a friend.
Who often will let you down?
Well, sometimes not. But yeah, it's been very often people letting me down. And I've learned to live with that. But that's why I miss it. I say, my God, if I had faith, then I'll be running to kneel down and pray to this supernatural power to get me out of the problem. But I don't. And people find it strange. But I think it's a given. It's a gift to have faith. It's a gift. So it's a gift that God never gave me. And I've learned to live without it.
I like the way you mix it. You have no faith in God.
No.
You believe faith is a gift. And you believe the absence of faith is also a gift.
Yeah, in fact, for me, it's a gift. It's also a gift.
And you also believe that God gave you that gift.
So no, I'm told that God, in fact, they say somebody pray that you remove this heart of the stone and put
the soft one. Stone so, cold heart.
I feel very happy and free that I take my decisions and suffer the consequences without
looking
to anything, any other. So I feel I'm a free person. So when I try to do wrong, I know I'm doing it knowingly, and I face the consequences. But it's my own decision. It's nobody's intervention. So sometimes I feel it's a blessing.
You talked about marriage. When did you get married? Vis-a-vis at what point in your career?
Third year, I think. My third year of service at UNESCO. And it was much more feeling that it's time for me to get married.
So why do you pick the bride? You came back home and...
I came back home.
And sourced for one that you had never met before.
I never met. In fact, she made me decide to get married. Reinforce my decision, my wish to get married, because she was very keen on getting married, and I was happy to have met her. She was a very beautiful girl. I think she was one of the most beautiful girls in Gayaza High School.
I can see the mention of her brings a sparkle to your eyes.
and we got on quite okay for 30 years. But then maybe as you grow older, your true personality has to take over. So I had a few differences, not of her own doing, but of her own being.
I love that. Not of her own doing,
not
but of her own being.
Yeah, okay. The way she was constituted and the way I was constituted, I think we came to a realization that
you are better off apart than
I
together.
I think so. And we get on very well now that we are apart. We talk, we help each other when there's need. And our children are also happy.
How many of these do you have?
There are three children who are grown up. So of course, one of them is married. An American lady. They've got two beautiful kids, very, very clever, very bright kids. So my wife, with those children, lives in Uganda. Mm-hmm. As I said, we talk, we meet, and then the children stay, come very rarely to Uganda, but they do come from time to time.
Okay.
And then I've got a fourth one whom I got here, a boy who is now 10 years of age.
Wow.
Which I think complements me. I've got three who are out there whom I don't think I've got an idea of coming back home.
And this and the one who is with you in the nest, that will otherwise be an empty nest.
That's right. So
let's play your next song. When we return, it will certainly be next week.
Okay.
Dr. Chazin, time is usually not an ally when a story is as beautiful as yours. When a career has been long lived,
yes,
and well done. So you'll agree, and the viewers I'm sure will agree with their indulgence, that you play your last song for tonight.
Right.
We take a breather and return next week.
Thank you. The last song was...
Jim Reeves, the choice of your Jim Reeves. Now what would you play?
Now it's Ecclesias Kawalia. Mm-hmm. I think it's called Susanna.
Wow, you're taking us to the good old...
Mm-hmm. That's the rhythm.
Do you have a Susanna in mind you're dedicating this song to?
No, I don't have any. In fact, I've never had a Susanna.
I'm using that girlfriend. In inverted commas.
Oh, okay. Oh, yeah. Because there can be another person within the
ambit of the song. Of exactly.
No.
It's a beautiful one for the week. And let's take a breather. This story you just want should change the guest and ask him to go over it. We'll return next week with OHT where Dr. Chazi completing his life story.
Desert Island Discs on 91.3 Capital FM. Desert Island Discs on 91.3 Capital FM.